yes to the call. I'm not afraid to fall. When I do it your way, you always save the day.
Family, we come again online to celebrate this day that the Lord has made, this first Sunday. And what I have learned to do, and first Sunday put me in the mind of the great sacrifice and the wonderful blessing that the Lord has given us in His Son Jesus for salvation. And so when I think about how awesome He is, that takes my mind off my stuff and put it on Him. And so I encourage you to do the same thing, whether it's a song or whether it's a scripture or just a simple prayer. When you are feeling some kind of way, just reflect on the awesomeness of our God. Let's pray. Father, we just thank You and we bless You for this wonderful day that You've given us. God, we thank You that truly You are our light and salvation, Lord God. And because You are great and greatly to be praised, God, we have no fear. Lord, we honor You this day and we thank You for the awesome work that Jesus did on the cross. In forgiving our sins and making a way for us, that He took our sins upon His own body and He took our sicknesses and our diseases. And so, Father, we are just so grateful that we can enjoy Your presence, oh God. We can enjoy the benefit of our salvation. And there are many benefits. And so, Lord, we just pray that You have Your way today, Lord God. In our entire world, God, we need You. The entire earth is moaning and groaning and crying out for You, oh God. And Lord, we thank You that Your ear is open to hear the cry of Your people. And so, Lord, we ask that You have Your way not only today, but, oh God, in all of the days to come. Father, we pray that You would just strengthen and fortify our hearts, oh God. Strengthen us when we get weak, oh God. Give us clarity in our minds and in our thoughts, Lord. Help us to continually, oh God, remember how loving You are and how faithful You are. Lord, we honor You and we bless You. We ask that You bless the higher level worship family and whoever is online watching. We pray a special blessing on our pastor and his family, oh God. Lord, we just thank You and we praise You for him. Lord, we love You, we honor You, and we do ask again that You have Your way. In Jesus' mighty name, amen, amen, amen. Hallelujah. Thank You, Lord.
gazing into eyes like fire. You're the only one that matters now, and all our fears are swept away as we see you face to face, surrounded by your love. I found a place of peace, a place of grace, wrapped in your embrace, and I don't wanna leave. Here in your presence, it's such a sweet release. I can feel your joy rushing over me, and I don't wanna leave.
Hallelujah. Scripture says, the Lord is my light and my salvation. So whom shall I fear? And of whom shall I be afraid? Yeah, the Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I be afraid?
Who shall I fear?
No one.
Who shall I fear? goodness of the Lord. The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear?
No one.
Whom shall I be afraid? The Lord is my light and salvation.
Whom
shall I
It is First Sunday Communion, where we come to remember and reflect on what our Lord and Savior did for us on Calvary's cross. So I pray that you're prepared as you grab your sacraments from your fridge or right there in your hand, that we prepare our hearts to partake. I want to ask you to just go into your closet of prayer for just a moment, asking the Lord God to prepare your heart that you might be able to partake. Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you, Father God, for your grace and mercy. Father God, I ask that you would search our hearts, O Lord God. Prepare us, O Lord God, that we may be found worthy, O Lord God, to reflect and remember and partake in Holy Communion. O Father, we thank you. In the mighty name of Jesus, amen, amen. I also pray this morning that the Lord God will bless the holy sacraments that we are about to receive. That it be, O Father God, unto us, O Father God, the great meaning of what our Lord and Savior did for us on Calvary's cross. This we ask and we thank you. Amen. The Bible says on the eve that our Lord and Savior was to be betrayed, he took his disciples into an upper room. There in the upper room, he took bread and he broke. He took wine and he poured. And with the bread, he said, this bread represents my body, which will be broken for you. He said unto them, take and eat. Eat ye all of it. Likewise with the wine he poured, he said, this wine represents my blood, which will be shed for you. He said, take and drink. Drink ye all of it. Hallelujah. Well, higher level family and friends, guests that are watching, you know if we were right here in the sanctuary, we'll be doing our favorite song. Amen. They're going to sing a little bit this morning, and you come on and sing along right where you are. The blood of Jesus has never lost his power. Hallelujah. Sing along with them right now in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Good morning, Higher Level. I am coming to bring you our announcements for this first Sunday, be kicking off our month of September. First of all, before I start, I want to celebrate fifth Sunday drive-in worship. We did it on fifth Sunday and really had a great time. It was good to see everybody. It is always a blessing to be able to do that and bring a word. And I want to say God bless you to all of those who served and helped out, the leaders, praise team, and you all. You did a fantastic job in making sure that experience was great. I also want to talk about one, you know, we have a Bible study that's ongoing every Wednesday night as we're talking about why do I need the church. That is the topic of study. Now, I am following that up with a sermon series on Sunday morning to bless you as we go deeper in the Word of God and encouraged in this season. I also want you to be reminded of Thursday evening prayer. As we are every Thursday evening, prayer goes forth. We're going to start praying about specific needs, specific topics, things that you can join in and pray for. I also want to remind you of something that's coming up as well. Matter of fact, we're kicking it off today, and that is getting registered to vote. This year is a critical year for voting. And from a local level, state level, even in federal level. If you want change, then let change happen because you're going out to vote. Make sure that you're getting registered to vote and also are committing to vote this November. You should have been doing it all year long from the primaries up until now, but we look forward to a great response. Therefore, in DeKalb County, because where our church is located as well, we are connecting with DeKalb Votes. It's an initiative by the Baptist Church Alliance, where several churches around DeKalb County are really encouraging and pushing their churches to be sure they're registered to vote and get out to vote. The flyer you see showing should let you know how you can mail in to vote. It's a safe way to do it, even though many don't want to go and can't get out during this pandemic. It's an easy way to make sure your vote is counted, as we are going to show up this year for it to have a great impact and making a difference in the change we need in many areas of our country and government. Lastly, let me just tell you, give you an update as to our church as far as re-entering the building. We have a time where we have just simply been planning to get ready for that. But I want you to know we are still holding fast with just doing online church. One is because, you know, we just haven't heard or seen a clearance from the science of the and of the CDC and the many others who are looking at this. But also, we know the winter season is coming up. And one of the things I dare not do is allow us to start and come back in and then also see a spike and going into what is considered this flu season. So we're taking those things in consideration and going to still maintain our monthly evaluation and do service online and move as the Lord God would have us to move. I'm in prayer about that. And I thank you for your faithfulness. And I pray that you continue to be blessed online and also be blessed as we are connecting together in our drive-through worship. So I praise God for those things. Wanted to update you in that. We evaluate it each week and each month and look forward to a time when we're able to come back together. I don't want it to be no restraints, to be even have to worry about the mask, but we're going to maintain safety and right now while we're waiting to do so. Well, those are our announcements on this morning. I'm going to bring you word in just a little bit, but God bless you for being with us, and I thank the Lord God for you, and we look forward to seeing you on line in worship just shortly. Be blessed, stay safe, and wear your mask.
All we want and all we need is found in Jesus, and all we ask is more of you. Cause nothing else can satisfy our heart's desire, and all we want is more of you. Shout it out.
we worship you in your holiness. More of your spirit, O God. Hallelujah.
Good morning. Once again, Higher Level. God bless you for joining us this morning as we are entering upon another month. This is the first Sunday of September. Can you believe it? As we're moving through this year. But I want to say to someone this morning, as you heard the song, as they worship, we need more of the Lord God. I pray this morning that he would give you more, that he would allow you to have more, see more, experience more of him. You know, as we've been doing the last couple of Sundays, I would normally ask is you take a moment to let's pray together. I would ask you to stand if you were here with me and grab each other by the hand. So I pray right now as you are with family and someone there with you, grab them by the hand. Let's begin to pray. Pray and ask the Lord God to give us more. Bless us on this morning. If no one's there, you are with the Lord God himself. As you would kneel and stand where you are, let us pray. Father, we thank you. Thank you, Father, for your goodness. We thank you for your grace and mercy. Father, we thank you, Father God, that we have the opportunity to come before your throne of grace to receive more. Oh, Lord God, somebody this morning need more of you, Father God. Father, just so they can make it through the week, Lord God, and make it through the month, oh, Lord God. Make it through this year, Lord God. Lord God, we just pray, Father God, right now by the power of your Holy Spirit, that you meet them where they are, wherever they are right now in their rooms. Father God, touch. We pray, oh Lord God, that your Holy Spirit would, oh Father, meet the needs of those, oh Father God, are calling you, looking for you, Father, around this country. Father, we just call on your name. We lift up your name. We glorify your name. Oh Father God, we just ask right now that you, oh Lord God, will meet us where we are. We, Father God, ask this in the mighty name of Jesus this morning. We give you all the glory, the honor, and the praise. It is in Jesus' name we ask. Amen, 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 amen. As I said, I just thank the Lord God for you on this morning. As you are joining us wherever you are in the different social media platforms, on our website, we're so glad you're with us. I'm beginning a new sermon series. The last month, I began a series that I really didn't intend for it to become, but the Lord God just had me to be there and was speaking through me out of 1 Peter and 2 Peter, and I just had to share with you what he was sharing with me. So I pray that you were blessed, but this was an intentional series here that I wanted to walk with you in, to allow it to run in conjunction with our Bible study on Wednesday nights. You are a few weeks ahead of me as we are studying there, but I want to pull up the rear with this series to bless you as well. And I just ask the Lord God on this morning to just allow us to just spend time with him today and allow us to be able to experience him in our time with him. So we thank the Lord God for his goodness, his grace, and his mercy on this morning. Amen. Amen. So this series, I'm going to be entitling it, Let the Church Say Amen. And it is important to you what I believe God has for us as the body of Christ. Yeah, yeah. And if you've been with us for the last month, as I taught through 1 Peter, then you know that it's been centered on speaking to and encouraging believers, encouraging believers in the body of Christ. And this particular series will be no different, but I want to talk to you about what it means for us to be the church, how we are to be the church, amen? It isn't going to be an encouraging word, but also it is a place in which I want us to understand and be encouraged and be in the church so that unbelievers would know this Christ that we believe in, that those who are lost in the world will find hope in their heart and life. Those who don't know what it means to have true worship and experience of God, that they will see your life, see your excitement, your joy, and want to be a part of the great worship experience you're having in higher level, but also in your life. Let them see how God is moving in your life. So this morning, title I want to give you is The Power in the Church. I want to begin it by talking to you about the power in the church out of Ephesians chapter 1. Verse 19 through 23. I really got to give you verse 18. This was supposed to cover parts of chapter 2 as well, but I know that I was not going to be able to give it all to you, so I need to be able to take my time. And can I take my time and walk you through what the Lord God has for you in this series? This is part teach. Of course, I'll preach when the Lord God give me a word to preach, but let it bless you on today. If you're there, go to Ephesians chapter 1, beginning at verse 19, verse 18. Let me go back to verse 18. Beginning at verse 18, we'll read down through verse 23. Here's what it says. The eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling, what are the riches of his glory, and is in his inheritance in the saints. This is Paul talking to the church of Ephesus, those Ephesians there in Ephesus. And verse 19, he says, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power, there that word is, power toward us who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all principalities, powers, and might and dominion, and every name that is named. King James says, above every name. Not only in this age, but also in that which is to come. Verse 22, and he put all things under his feet and gave him to be the head of all things to the church, which is, verse 23, his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. Who fills all in all. Let me say to you this morning, if you ever needed anything, we need the power of God in our lives today, in our country, in our world, and the things that are going on around us. We need the power of God, particularly in our lives. Yeah, if you've ever been gripped by evil or shame, bitterness and hate, lust and immorality, cursing and anger, robbery and assault, murder and war, selfishness and greed, division and strife, disappointment and emptiness, boredom and purposelessness. We desperately need the power of God to overcome and deal with these things that we may have encountered in our lives, but more importantly, in this world around us, in our society. But I want to talk to you about how we need the power of God in our daily lives as we walk and deal with and live out this life. Yeah, the good news is this. The good news is that God offers his power to us. He offers his power to us. He offers his power to us through his son, Jesus Christ. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And what you find here that Paul is speaking this to the Ephesians. He's offering the same power of connection in Jesus to the Ephesians. Yeah, yeah. He's praying for the Ephesians that they might know God personally and intimately in their lives. Yeah, for God is the one who gives the power to those who truly come to know him, those who truly place their life in his care. Coming to know God, saints, coming to know God is the key to receiving the power of God. Coming to know God is the key to receiving the power of God. Yeah, yeah. So let me share with you what Paul makes clear to us in Ephesians about the power of God working in our lives. He begins to tell us in chapter 1, verse 18 through 19, he says this. He says, God's great power is available to all believers. Let me go there and tell you. He says, God's great power is available to all believers. And verse 19, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power towards us who believe, according to the working of his mighty power. Yeah, what I want you to understand is this. When a believer really knows God, he experiences the power of God. Yeah. The power of God for himself and working in his life to himself. Yeah. In verse 19, you got to note something. You got to note something in verse 19, how God's power is described. How God's power is described. It says, verse 19 says, it is exceeding. God's power is exceeding. Let me build my case right quick. Exceeding means surpassing. Exceeding means unlimited. Exceeding means immeasurable. Exceeding means beyond imagination. Beyond imagination. He says it is exceeding, but then he also says it is great. He says God's power is great. God's power being great means that it is mighty. It is explosive. Yeah, dunamis. It is beyond measure. Yeah. This word that we find when he says great in his description is megathos in his Greek, in the Greek. Yeah. And we get that word from megathon, which measures atomic explosive. It measures atomic explosive. And what I want you to grab in this as he describes this is this. It is to imagine the explosive power of God. Yeah. The explosive power of God. Amen. And God takes the power, his power, and extends it. He extends it. God then, he presents it, and he makes it available to believers. Makes it available to believers. Yeah. Let me go ahead and give you, I'll say it again a little later on, but he says to us in Acts 1 and 8, after this that the Holy Spirit has come upon us, we shall receive power. Receive power. Well, how do we do this? How do we get this power? How do we do this? Yeah, well, we get it because of what Jesus did for us. Yeah, because of what Jesus did for us. What God did in Christ, for Christ, he will do for us. What God did in giving power and authority to his son, Jesus Christ, he will do the same for you and I. Yeah. So understand, God wants us to have his great power. Number two, if you're walking along with me and keeping, taking the notes. Yeah, number two, the power of God is the same power that raised Jesus from the dead. That's what God did for Jesus. He raised him from the dead. And when he got up, he said that he gave him all power and all authority. Yeah. The resurrection is what we're talking about here, saying the resurrection. Believers are to experience the power of God, which is the same power that raised Jesus from the dead. Yeah. Can you imagine the enormous power needed to raise someone from the dead, to raise someone from the dead. Well, I can tell you this, it was not a problem for the Lord God himself. But when you just try to imagine that, it takes something enormous to happen for a person to be raised from the dead. Here's what Acts chapter 2, 23 through 24 tell us. Yeah. It says, him being delivered by the determinate counsel and the foreknowledge of God. Ye have taken, and by wicked hands have crucified and slain whom God raised up, talking about Jesus, having loosed the pains of death. Look now, having loosed the pains of death, having raised him up with power, but having loosed the pains of death, amen, over your life, amen, that came with death. Yeah. And he says, I like what Paul says, because it was not possible that he should be holding of it. In other words, it was impossible for Jesus to stay in the grave. It was impossible for Jesus to stay bound. It was impossible because the power of God, amen, touched him and brought him forth. Oh, good God Almighty. Amen. So it couldn't keep him there. Yeah. Couldn't keep him there. Could not hold him. Yeah, yeah, yeah. So we find Acts makes the case, but it also says in Acts chapter 3, verse 14 through 15, but ye denied the Holy One and the just, and desired a murderer to be granted unto you. Here, this is what Acts says now. Luke is the writer of Acts. He says, and kill the Prince of Life, whom God has raised from the dead, whereof we are witnesses. Luke is the writer of the book of Acts. He's letting us see here and understand. They wanted a murderer to be given away for someone who did no harm, did anything wrong, all in an effort to try to quench or stamp out the power of God in the Prince of Life. Yeah. But it says God raised them from the dead, whereof Luke says we were witnesses. And Acts chapter 10 goes on to say, I got to give you a few supporting scriptures here to help you fully understand. And we are all witnesses of all things which he did, both in the land of Jews and in Jerusalem, whom they slew and hanged on a tree. Him God raised up the third day and showed him openly, not to all the people, but unto witnesses chosen before God, even to us who did eat and drink with him after he rose from the dead. He said, Luke is saying, you know what? We are witnesses of this power because he not only got up, he came and sat down and talked with us. He ate with us and fellowship with us. We were able, amen, to witness this power. Yeah, 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 yeah. Here's the point that's being made in this. The point is, when God raised Jesus Christ, he demonstrated three things he did for men, three things he did for you and I. He showed men that he had the power to do these three things, First of all, the first one is, these are sub-points if you want them, it showed that God has the power to conquer all trials and temptations of life. It showed that God has the power to conquer all trials and temptations of life. When Jesus went to the cross, he went to the cross bearing our sins. He went to the cross bearing our temptation. He went to the cross bearing our trials, the things that we'll go through so that we would have power and authority. Yeah, 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 yeah. So God gave him the power through Christ, us the power through Christ, amen, to conquer all trials, all temptations of life. Yeah, here's what 1 Corinthians 10, 13 tell us. There has no temptation, no trial, amen, taken you but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able, but will with the temptation also make a way of escape, that ye may be able to bear it, amen, by the same power and authority, even if it did try to overwhelm you, even if it did try to overtake you, even those things that come at you in your life, in your flesh, in who you are, that try to overtake you, he says it can't do it because he will show up and give you a way of escape. Why? Even when it seems like it has a hold of you, even when it seems like you're having to endure it, he says, I'll give you what you need. I'll give you the power to bear it. That's what Paul says in 1 Corinthians 10, 13. He also says in 2 Corinthians 12 and 9, and he said unto me, my grace is sufficient. There's the power of grace, saints. My grace is sufficient for thee. For my strength is made perfect in your weakness. My power, amen, is made perfect in your weakness. For when you are weak, oh, good God Almighty, he says, when you are weak in your infirmities, he said, the power of Christ will rest upon you and make you strong. That's what Paul says to us in 2 Corinthians 12 and 9. Yeah, yeah, yeah. So it showed that God has the power to conquer all trials and temptations of our life. Number two, it showed that God has the power to give man a new life. that God has the power to give man a new life and a power to live this new life. Yeah, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creation. All things have passed away, and all the old things have passed away, and all things have become new. You get a new look, you get a new walk, a new talk, but you also get the power of God, amen, working and operating in your life as a part of that walk. So he said, God shows his power to give man a new life. That's what the power of Christ's death, being raised from dead, did for you and I. Yeah. So in this, he says, after Christ was raised from the dead, when he was raised from the dead, he was not still in his old life. He was not living in even who he was before he went to the cross. Remember when they came to him and saw him after he was raised and wanted to touch him, he said, hold up, don't touch me, for I have not ascended to my Father just yet. In other words, you can't touch me in the newness of who I am. You can't touch me in the power of who I am right now. Amen. So even Jesus transformed from the old life to the new life. Yeah. He was a new man that was now preparing to ascend to the Father. He had a new life, amen, and a glorified body. Oh, good God Almighty. Yeah. Because he had been raised from the dead, he was now operating in the glorified body, in the newness of who he was and is. Amen. Yeah. And therefore, because of that, we also have the privileges of this new life, that we can walk before God and walk before man and walk this life out in the newness of the power and authority and the glory of God. Yeah. Here's what he tells us in Romans 6 and 4. He tells us in Romans 6 and 4, therefore, we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ, there it is, was raised up from the dead by the glory, by the power of the Father, even so we should also walk in the newness of life. Amen. He said we have this privilege. Yeah, Jesus gives us, he gives you the power to walk in the newness of life, of who we are and not in who we used to be. Not in who they say you used to be. You're no longer who they say they used to be. You're who God says you are. You're walking in the newness of who God says you are. Oh, good God Almighty. Yeah, that's a word for somebody. It ought to encourage somebody today. Because you are walking in the newness of Christ, no longer bound by the things of yesterday, the problems of yesterday, the pain of yesterday, the mindset, the attitudes of yesterday, the people you dealt with on yesterday, God has given you a newness of understanding how, amen, to deal with them as well. The newness of life in the power of Jesus Christ. In the power of Jesus Christ. Yeah. But he goes on to say in Ephesians 4:24, another place, that ye put on the new man, which after God is created in righteousness and holiness. You get all of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Yeah. Paul says, you got the power, I need you to walk in it. You got the power. I need you to walk in it. That's what his prayer was for the Ephesians. That's what his encouragement is for us today. You have the power. I need you to walk in it. You know, there was a song in the early 90s by Snap that was called I Got the Power. I Got the Power. And I remember this song, and there was a point in the song where the rapper would say, it's getting kind of hectic. it's getting kind of hectic. That is one of the places in the song that the rapper was saying. But I remember the young lady who was a part of the song, she would come in and say, yeah, when he would say, it's getting kind of hectic, but she kept saying, I got the power. I got the power. Let me make that applicable to you and I. Because you have the power, even though hectic things, even though life, even though issues, even though things might get hectic in and around your life, you still have the power to overcome. You still have the power to walk it out. You still have the power of discernment, the power of the gift of God, the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Even when you can't deal with it, he'll step in and deal with it for you. Oh, that's good news. That's good news. All because you have the power of Jesus Christ through his resurrection working in your life. Third sub point, third sub-point. He says, the power to raise Christ from the dead shows that God has the power to raise men from the dead. Yeah, the believer shall experience a great resurrection power, amen, and be resurrected even from the dead. Even from the dead, man shall. Now we see the miraculous things that happen all the time when God even touched people's lives, even today. Not just the Lazarus. Yeah, not just the Lazarus. Yeah, but God still does great miracles even today. When you find someone in the hospital or the doctor says, I have pronounced them dead, but all of a sudden, a heartbeat begins to be revived or they begin to breathe again. It happens all around this world, and those are miraculous moments that God himself shows up in the midst of. But what Paul helps us to see, not only if we may not experience or see that happen in life today, but he does give us a promise in that great day, in that great day. John in chapter 5, 28 through 29, here in his gospel, he says, marvel not at this, for the hour is coming in that which all that are in the grave shall hear his voice and shall come forth. They that have done good unto the resurrection of life, and they that have done evil unto the resurrection of damnation. God says, by that same power, I'm going to raise up those who know me and going to go and live with me, but I'm also going to raise up those that I'm going to have to judge and live eternally from me in hell. Oh, good God Almighty. He says, by that same power, I'm able to raise up man, Yeah. I hope you're walking with me, understanding the power of God, that comes to us through Jesus Christ, Yeah. And he says in John chapter 6, verse 40, he says, and this is the will of him that sent me, Jesus says, that everyone who seeth the Son and believeth on him may have everlasting life and will raise him up in the last day. We are sure that even when Jesus come back, even when he goes to take his rightful place, we're going to be raised up to go with him. Yeah, raised up to go with him. Yeah, Thessalonians tells you in that moment, it'll be in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye. We'll be caught up with him in the sky. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Point number three, that we experience the great power of God in our lives. But we also experience the power of God's resurrection in our lives. But number three, the power that sets Jesus in his rightful place, we're going to experience. Yeah. Believers ought to experience the power of God, the same power that took Jesus and placed him at the right hand of his Father. I'm building a case to help you understand that the power that resides in the church, that's you and I, the power that resides in you and I, amen, gives us the power to be able to do things above our thinking, above our hearing, above what our eyes can even begin to grasp. Yeah. So, but he says, this is the power that set Jesus at the right hand of the Father. Yeah. You know, God didn't just have the power to resurrect his son. He didn't just have the power to resurrect his son. He had the power to take him from this dimension into the next dimension of where he belonged in the spiritual realm. Yeah, in the spiritual realm, where he is. Bring him from where he sent him here on this earth to where he belongs with him in his rightful place. Yeah. God the Father brought God the Son to himself and put him in his rightful place at the right hand, at his right hand. Yeah. I love Mark's gospel. Mark's gospel in chapter 16, verse 19 said this. So then after that, the Lord has spoken unto them, he said he was received up into heaven and sat at the right hand of God. This is what Jesus says of himself after he is now about to be ascended. He says, so then after the Lord has spoken to them, he was received up into heaven and sat on the right hand of God. Oh, I love it. I love it. I do you one even better. Here's what Stephen said. This is what Stephen said in Acts chapter 7. This is what he was saying when he was full of the Spirit after being stoned. He said, the Bible said, being full of the Holy Ghost, he looked up steadfastly into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing on the right hand of God. He said, behold, I see the heavens open and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. Oh, good God Almighty. Jesus had taken his rightful place to give Stephen a standing ovation, amen, for being able to endure, for being able to overcome, for being able to stand under the power of God, amen, even while he was being stoned. Oh, good God Almighty. We got to know and understand today when we are standing in the power of God, we begin to see how God himself, how God the Father and the Son begin to give us a standing ovation and saying, well done, and saying that I see you, amen, standing faithfully, standing boldly, standing strong on me and my word. Oh, good God Almighty. Yeah. Stephen was able to see this as he looked into heaven. I see him standing at the right hand of God. Yeah. So in a way, he took Christ into heaven. He took our Lord and Savior into heaven, and he exalted him. He exalted him in order to demonstrate that he has the power to take men out of this world and bring them into heaven to be with him. Oh, that's the part of the assurance of your salvation, that when this life is over, God says he's going to bring you to take your rightful place to be with him. Somebody needs to know this morning that God wants to exalt you in your life. God wants to exalt you to your rightful place. Amen. And get this. He doesn't just want to do it right in the heavenly realm. He wants to do it right here where you are right now. This is what his word says in Matthew. He says, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. God says, I need you to begin to duplicate, amen, being exalted to your rightful place down here long before you even get up there. I got a place ready for you, amen. I have a mansion prepared for you. I have a place ready for you at where I am in heaven. But I want to exalt you down here where you are right now. God says, if you begin to grow in my word, if you begin to mature, if you begin to strengthen your faith, if you begin to walk with me, if you begin to build a relationship with me, I will begin to place you in places that you had never seen and begin to allow you to experience things that you have never experienced, all because of the power that I have. Just as I seated my son in his rightful place, I'll seat you in your rightful place. Oh, what word is that for somebody this morning? Who is that for on this morning? He says, the power that seats Jesus at the right hand of the Father in heaven. But number four, it says the power that exalted Jesus above all. You got to understand this. Because if you don't believe Jesus is over all, then your faith, then you trusting your relationship, the power that you're trying to walk in is useless. So you got to know that if Jesus, he's not just in all, he is above all. Yeah, this is the power that we are able to experience that exalted Jesus above all. Yeah. Saints, all of us, all believers, we are to experience the power of God that exalted Jesus Christ. Overall and in all. Yeah. That exalted Jesus Christ over all creatures, that exalted him both in this world and the next world to come, our text says. Yeah. He said, Jesus being seated at the right hand of God means that he has the highest seat of honor. He has the highest seat of authority in all the universe. In all the universe. Yeah. What God did was exalt Jesus to rule and to reign over all. Yeah. To rule and to reign over all. When we read in Matthew, when it says that he got up with all power. He got up with all authority that was given to him. Jesus said, given to me. Given to me in heaven and on into earth, in earth. Amen. Amen. So overall means, it means no matter how great or how powerful what this world may seem or what the enemy feels like he might have control of, he does not have any power and authority. You know, I love it because even when God speaks, when God speaks to Job, and Job, he says that when Satan and the angels are coming before God, they are all coming to present their case. But you notice in Job when he says, you know, to Satan, where have you been? He said, I've been going to and fro looking for whom I may devour. But I want you to catch this. God allowed him to be able to come and present. So in other words, Satan has no authority to do anything unless God permits him. Oh, good God Almighty. And matter of fact, when he speaks of Job, he tells him, you can attack Job. You can oppress Job. He says, but you can't touch his life. You can't touch his life. So in other words, he can't do anything unless God permits. Oh, good God Almighty. I'm saying what I'm saying to you, while most folks that allow Satan to deceive to think that he has authority and can do things and harm them and overcome them in their life, it is to understand that God, he can't do anything unless God says so. Unless God releases his power. And it wasn't until God says, okay, I'm going to take the hedge of protection from around Job, then you can begin to mess with him. Oh, good God Almighty. That's for somebody this morning. But we need to understand, because of this power, because of God's power, he exalted Jesus above all. Jesus is our Lord. He is our Savior. Oh, good God. He reigns in our heart and lives. Therefore, he has all power and authority over everything and all things pertaining to us in our lives. Yeah, yeah. We get to experience this because we are connected or in Jesus Christ. Yeah, 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 yeah. Jesus is above all principalities. He's above all powers. He's above all mights and all dominions. He's above all. Yeah. And just to make sure, now catch this, you got to get this. And just to make sure that it's confirmed, here's what it says in the text. Yeah. Here's what it says in the text. It says, Jesus, in verse 21 of our text, verse 21, look what it said. Just to be sure that he is above all, he says, he is far above all principalities and power and might and dominion. And catch this, and every name that is named. Every name that is named, every name that is anything, everything that might have a name to even proclaim, it might have power. He has authority and power over that. Oh, good God Almighty. Look, let me break it down to you and make it applicable today. You name it. If it's pain, he has power and authority over that. If it's financial struggle, he has power and authority over that. If it's sickness and disease, he has power and authority over that. Oh, let me make it relevant for you. Amen. If it's marital problem, he has power and authority over that. Oh, good God Almighty. If it's problem with your kids, he has power and authority over that. If it's government, he has power and authority over that. If it's economy, he has power and authority over that. Whatever you can put a name to, his name is above that name. Oh, good God Almighty. And at the name of Jesus, the word of God says, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that he is Lord. Somebody ought to give God praise for that. Somebody ought to lift up the name of God. You name it, God, Jesus has authority and power over it. Over it. Yeah, 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 yeah. Here's what Peter says. Here's what Peter says. He says in 1 Peter 3 and 22, who has gone into heaven? And who is on the right hand of God? Angels and authorities and powers being made subject unto him. All things are made subject unto Jesus Christ. Here's the point, saint. Here's the point. The point is this. God gave Jesus Christ the authority to rule and reign over all, including your life. Yeah. He demonstrated his power, he has the power to exalt us. So that we can rule and reign with Christ. Yeah, I told you a few weeks ago, if you suffer with him, you also going to reign with him. Oh, good God Almighty, you're going to reign with him. That's God's promise to us, saints. It's God's promise to us. First of all, he told us in Genesis, we shall have dominion. Yeah, yeah. But when it's with his authority, he says in Matthew, that we too, he said, the Lord said unto him, well done, good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of the Lord. God says, in him, you will have the same ability to reign, oh, good God Almighty, and have authority. You already got the dominion. All you got to do is begin to walk in it. All you got to do is begin to walk in it. Yes, yes, yes. Number five, my last point. Here it is in verse 22 through 23. Look what it says. Verse 22 through 23. It says, and he put all things under his feet and gave him to be the head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. Yeah, yeah. Saints, the power of God placed Jesus at the head of his church. Yeah, and we experience this power of God that made Jesus the head of the church. Who is the church? We are the church that made Jesus the head of your life, the head of my life, our lives. Yeah, yeah. Jesus paid the ultimate price to build the church. He paid the ultimate price to build the church. He died for it. He died for it. Yeah. Therefore, God gave him the supreme position over the church. Yeah. And the church, saint, is called the body of Christ. You and I are called the body of Christ. Here's where the power in the church come. I need you to get this today. I'm building a case over these next several weeks. Yeah. It is a picture. What he paints is a picture here of the human body. Yeah. Yeah. With Christ being the head. Yeah, and the church, you and I are the body. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And in 1 Corinthians, we see that he spells this out in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. And when he says the body can't function without the head. Yeah, it cannot function without the head. And the head must have a body to carry out the functions designed for it. The plans that God designed for it. Yeah, yeah. Christ came to bring the plan of peace and reconciliation to a world of lostness, to a world of dying souls, to men and women, men and women who were alienated from God. You and I were once alienated from God. Yeah, yeah. He did this so that we now could have right relationship, could be reconciled unto the Lord God himself. Yeah. Now, the body, the church, you and I, the church must carry out God's plan. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Must carry out God's plan. The message of peace. Y'all got to hear this. Yeah, this is a teach, preach message, but it's an encouragement to you. The message of peace and the power of Christ must be taken to the world by the church. But must be taken to your neighbor, must be taken to your lost child, taken to your lost coworker, taken to those, to your boss, taken to whomever he would have you to, because in Acts chapter 8, 1 verse 8, it says, after this, that the power of the Holy Spirit has come upon you, you shall receive power. And he says, you shall be my witnesses. Witnesses. Not just the witnesses of his breakthrough, of his goodness, of his mercy, but the witness of the good news of the gospel, that same power, amen, that saved you, amen, that same power that changed you, that same power that gave you eternal security in Jesus Christ, you ought to take it to somebody else. Oh, I told you this word is an encouragement to the church and who we need to be as the church. Amen. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And in other words, the point of the premise of this point is this. If God has the power to create the church and make Christ the head of the church, then he has the power to make us as a body function and work for Christ. Yeah, we are God's workmanship created in Christ Jesus, Ephesians 2, 8 and through 10 tell us. Yeah, 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 yeah. God has the power to get us busy for him. God has the power to do great work in and through our lives. The power to help us in our witnesses, the witnessing. The power to stir up in us a good word, a testimony, amen, to proclaim the message of Jesus Christ. The message of Jesus Christ, yeah. Yeah, yeah. This word blessed me because I want us to understand in this season of all that is going on is important. In these last days, it is important for us to be the church. Yeah. And I need you to know something, saint. God says, the word of God says in 2 Timothy 1:7, he has not given us a spirit of fear, but he has given us a spirit of power, of love, and of sound mind. Yeah, the question is, are you going to walk in that power? Are you going to use that power, amen, to fulfill the purpose and plan of God in your life, but also for his church? Saints, if you really want to experience the blessings and favor and the power of God in your life, if you really want to experience it, start believing in the power of his church. Start believing in the power of his church. Yeah, yeah. Here's what the power of God promises to do. Here's what the power of God promises to do for his church. If you and I be his church, if you be the church, here's what the power of God promises to do. In chapter 16 of Matthew, verse 18, here's what it said. And I tell you, here's what he told Peter when he told him, be the church. When he said, Peter, feed my sheep, here's what he needed Peter to understand about being the church. He says in verse 18, and I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church. Oh, got to get this. And the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. The gates of hell shall not prevail against you, shall not prevail against your life, shall not prevail against the gospel of Jesus Christ that you testify about in your life. Yeah, 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 yeah. He says, God said, nothing will prevail against my plan, nothing will prevail against your purpose, and nothing will prevail against my power. Oh, so that's good news. Somebody ought to give God some praise this morning. Somebody ought to give him praise. Thank you for the power of Jesus Christ operating in my life. Thank you for the power of the Holy Spirit at work in his church. Saints, I just came to tell you this morning, yeah, this is the power in the church. Jesus is the power in the church. And I declare to somebody this morning, if you're watching, if you're listening, and you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, then you're missing out on the power to see your life change, transform. If you know him, then you understand there is a great purpose and a plan upon our lives to walk in this power and authority, to walk in who God had purposed us in Jesus Christ. So the first invitation, if you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, I invite you to accept him. Give your heart and life to him. Make a decision and say, I've decided. If you do know him, let us begin to live out and operate in the power that I just laid out for you so eloquently that Jesus wants to fulfill in your life. Perhaps in the third invitation, you want to be a part of a body of Christ. who allows the power of God, the power of the Lord Jesus Christ to reign. We know that we can't do nothing without him, but with him, all things are possible. We can do all things through Christ, and I keep on seeing God do great and mighty things. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Yes. Yes.
To what his plans are, to what his word says, God has spoken.
God has spoken. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. The song said, let it make this your response. Even in healing, whatever it is, in the raising of the dead, he is. Come on, let that minister to you. Hallelujah.
So let the church say,
thank you, Jesus.
Lift your hands where
You can lift your hands right there. You are the church, right where you are. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen means so be it. So be it in your life, so be it in your purpose, in your plan, in your problem, but so be it in His church. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Yes. Yes. Open up your mouth. Thank you, Lord. Yeah. Yeah. I pray that you allow the Lord God to speak to your heart today. Amen. Come on and say amen. Say amen down in your belly from your spirit. Amen. That we will begin to be the church that the Lord God wants to work in. I pray the word bless you on today. I pray it bless you in your spirit, down in your soul, as we understand the power that we have in Christ to be the men and women, but also to be His church. Well, as we get ready to sign off every week, I just want to thank you for watching. Thank you for joining us and having a great time and fellowship with us. And as we are preparing to go, I want you to remember how good God has been to you, how He's given you an amen in spite of everything that's happening, that He's still able to provide, take care of your needs, and bless you. And out of that, we want to say, Lord God, we thank you by giving unto Him. You know, this is an opportunity, even as today, for you to give and continue to sow, that we may continue to do the work of the church and be the body of Christ. And you can give through our app, give through our text to give. You can give by mailing it into our church. Amen. Also, you can also make sure that you can even drop it off and we'll receive it there as well. But we thank you for being a blessing and allowing the Lord God to be a blessing to the house of God and what we're doing. Also with that, I just want to remind you of the things that are coming up, that Bible study we have each week. And remember to get plugged in. Let's stay connected higher level. Amen. Lastly, I want you to make sure you stay safe. Stay safe until God sees us through this and it is over. God bless you. Let us lift our hands as we do every Sunday. We say together now unto that same sweet Jesus who is manifested in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen of angels, and received in glory. May He bless these His children, now, henceforth, and forevermore. Let all of God's saints say amen. Amen. Say, I will be the church. I will be the church and walk in His power and authority. God bless you. I'll see you next week. Same place, same time. Know that I love you, and the Lord Jesus loves you even more. Be blessed.